I'll be the first, but certainly not the last. And I want to make sure that we are not just opening that door, but breaking it down.
Ricky Hurtado wants to be the first Latino Democrat to win a seat in the 300-year history of the North Carolina State House. North Carolina has been ground zero for extreme Republican gerrymandering, and a Democratic takeover of the legislature would give Hurtado the opportunity to get politicians out of the business of choosing their own voters. He has the endorsements of Barack Obama and the Biden-Harris ticket, and is running to represent a county that Donald Trump won in 2016. What would being the first Democratic Latino representative mean to you and your community?
A reporter asked me the same question about a week ago. She goes, you have a huge role, right? You're not just gonna represent District 63 if you win, but you're gonna represent the over million Latinos who have never had a representative when they go to the General Assembly. Your office is gonna be packed 24/7. And so I had to laugh, and I recognized the challenge and opportunity that exists there. And so my hope is that, as a first, the advice I've always gotten from mentors and folks I look up to has been, you should be the first, but you should never be the last. And so you should always have someone that's mentoring you to make sure that you are, growing in this position, but also looking behind you and who you bring up with you. And so that's my vision for this position, for North Carolina, for the next 10 years, right? It's like, how are we building a pipeline where across rural North Carolina in particular, young Latinos who are excited about investing in their community, that are eager to be a part of the conversation in North Carolina, making sure they know that they can run for city council, that they can run to be the next mayor of Sanford or Burlington, that they can serve to be the next county commissioner or the next state legislator of their district.
If you got to pick your own personal theme song, what would it be?
My shot, Hamilton, right? It's Lin-Manuel Miranda. I mean, that is the quintessential story of America and my story and my campaign story. And on top of that, I've actually had the opportunity to get to know the Miranda family a bit over the course of this election, his dad in particular. Luis Miranda is the chairman of the Latino Victory Fund, and they've endorsed me, the only candidate they've endorsed in North Carolina, because they recognize the historic nature of the race and they want to be sure that they're investing in the South as well. And so you just got to keep playing that soundtrack over and over and over till we get to that end.
What was your family's journey to the United States?
My parents are from El Salvador, from Central America. And in 1980, they made a decision with my grandma to flee the country, as many Salvadoran families were fleeing at the time, right at the beginning of the conflict that lasted over 10 years in El Salvador. They fled their home country, and eventually made it to Los Angeles, which was the first stop of many Salvadoran families. Thankfully, they were able to benefit from comprehensive immigration reform in the mid-80s and were able to come out of the shadows and really start a new life here in the United States. I was born in Los Angeles, but then we pretty quickly moved to North Carolina when I was about 7 years old, mainly because of my own health. I had asthma, severe asthma, and the big city of Los Angeles just wasn't cutting it for my lungs. And so I had to sleep with a respirator every night, had to get two shots every day, just to be able to really live. That on top of something else that happened in the early 90s, actually, which was the Rodney King riots, which was my parents' first experience of racial tension in America. And they weren't quite sure what was happening. And so they made a decision that maybe it might be time to leave the city. And we had a family friend who had made the trek to North Carolina before we did and said, literally, it's really green here. I can find you a job. And so we sold everything. My parents and my family, we drove across the country, took us 7 days to get to North Carolina. And we landed in rural North Carolina where I grew up. And so that was our journey. And at every step of the way, my dad has always had the mentality of we just have to figure it out.
How does your family's immigration story inform your platform?
My parents still to this day, they've been out of the country for 40 years. They still long to return home. They're citizens now. They love this country, but they miss El Salvador so much. There's YouTube channels now, right, of people sort of reality TV recording their lives in like little villages in El Salvador. That's what they watch. So it just sort of shows you that if people had the choice, they would stay home. So many people don't. And there's a reason why they flee home. And if we truly want to see a different type of immigration happening in the United States, we have to invest in the countries where these challenges are happening.
What's the first thing you would do if COVID-19 were cured tomorrow?
I think you'd call an emergency meeting with community leaders and trusted sources of information to make sure that we can create a plan that works for our community. We are facing unprecedented crisis and trust in our politics. We recognize that if we want people to be healthy and to really recover both from this public health and economic crisis, we're going to have to become brokers of trust in that process. We've seen in North Carolina that COVID-19 has disproportionately impacted the Black and Latino community. That's the case also, you know, in many parts of the country. This is something that impacted me firsthand. My wife and I got COVID over the summer. And so we had to, you know, navigate that. We were pretty sick for about 3 weeks. I still have asthma. And so we went through about 3-4 days where I was really scared, to be honest. I tried to play it cool for my wife and my mom. But, you know, we just didn't know with the uncertainty of how this plays out, whether I'd have to, you know, be rushed to the hospital or not. Thankfully, we are young, we're healthy, we were able to navigate it at home. We didn't have to be hospitalized, but we know that's not the case for everyone.
North Carolina has seen anti-democratic gerrymandering. How do races like yours fit into the bigger picture on fair voting laws and racial equality?
In my district, connecting racial inequity and racial injustice to gerrymandering and voter suppression is actually a common conversation that we're having, because people understand what this practice means, right? It means that we do not have a voice in these elections, which means that the issues that people in our district care about aren't being addressed. Our map was actually redrawn in 2019 because the state courts here found that we were part of a cluster of districts that were illegally gerrymandered. For me, it's more about balance than about who has power, right? Because with balance comes compromise. And with compromise means more fairness and equality in our democratic system. And so if Democrats are able to take back at least one chamber in the General Assembly, that means that in 2021, when it comes time to redistrict, we will be able to implement maps that will have an impact, not just the next 2 years, but the next 10 years, which means greater representation in each community. And it means fairer congressional districts, even. One race here in North Carolina, a group of 50,000 plus voters, could have a huge effect on what the makeup of Congress looks like in the next 10 years.
What did you learn as a teacher in North Carolina that has formed and shaped your views on education and what we need to do to improve education?
I didn't have my first Latino educator until I got to college. And that experience of connecting with someone who could say, oh, I get it, right? Or would just sort of navigate Spanglish with me. It seems like a little thing, but it leaves a huge influence on you in, you know, now connecting with a potential role model who might be setting you up for grad school or who might be able to help you navigate a system that you're unfamiliar with. Those are the sorts of things that actually really matter in an education setting. And I've seen it now sort of in a full circle moment happen with me, right? I teach a college class at the School of Education at UNC, and I work with middle school and high school students in the college initiative that I lead. And at every level, we've seen students' eyes light up when they finally see someone who might answer questions in Spanish to them. Every day, the first day of class, I will have a line of students, from Latino students in particular, who said, this is the first time I've ever had a Latino professor, or this is the first time that I've seen my own experience reflected in the curriculum. You see just greater engagement, greater enthusiasm, a willingness to ask questions they may not have asked in another setting because they weren't comfortable. In a diverse society, we have to have culturally competent teachers that reflect the lived experiences of our students. This is not just a moral imperative, it's an educational and economic imperative, right? In North Carolina, we are projecting that in the year 2030, we're going to be close to about 500,000 jobs short of fulfilling the needs for our workforce. And that's because of people who don't have the proper credentials to actually fulfill those jobs. And so that means that our students in the classroom now, in this moment, we're going to have to be preparing for the jobs of the future. We are breaking down barriers. Their lived experience is actually their strength and not their weakness.